Hello and welcome to Issues of the Moment. Nigeria has the second largest HIV epidemic in the world and one of the highest rates of new infection in sub-Saharan Africa. Many people living with HIV in Nigeria are unaware of their status. Nigeria continues to fall short of providing the recommended number of HIV testing and counseling sites. Low levels of access to antiretroviral treatment remains an issue for people living with HIV, meaning that there are still many AIDS-related deaths in Nigeria. Punitive laws against homosexuality mean that men who have sex with men face difficulties accessing HIV services. Nigeria also has the fourth largest tuberculosis epidemic in the world, with HIV and TB co-infection now becoming an increasing concern. And on this week's edition, we would be looking at AIDS and COVID-19 in Nigeria. Thank you so much for joining us. My name is Justin Bemunyi, and I welcome you to the program. Once again, thank you so much for joining us on the program. This is Issues of the Moment. And this week's edition, we will be looking at AIDS and COVID-19 in Nigeria. My guest is the Director General of the National Agency for the Control of AIDS, NACA, Dr. Gambo Ali. Thank you so much for joining us on the program.
Pleasure to be here once again.
All right, we're talking about AIDS and COVID-19 in Nigeria. You know, despite several interventions by the government and donor agencies over the years, you know, Nigeria still remains the fourth largest country with the HIV pandemic in terms of burden, according to statistics. What are we not doing right? You know, especially now that there are reported cases of increase in number of this pandemic.
So maybe you should ask, what are we doing right? Not what are we doing right, simply because a couple of years back, Nigeria is the second largest burden after South Africa. When we were thinking we have an epidemic or burden that is that large as 3.5 million people living with HIV/AIDS. But now, just 2 years back or 3 years back, we just discovered, you know, in our only effort here nationally, that our burden is not up to 3.5, the number of people that are living with HIV/AIDS are not up to 3.5 million. We have something that is less than 2 million, precisely about 1.8, 1.9 million. So coming down from a ranking being second largest burden in the world to now fourth largest burden, we need to ask the question of what is Nigeria doing right for us to move down the ranking from 3.5 million to 1.8 million. And you said number of new cases. We should be talking about number of newly identified cases, but not new cases, yeah. With the current position of Nigeria in terms of treatment coverage, with the current position of Nigeria in terms of service delivery and access to service, and in terms of awareness, we should see new infection going down, and we should see death from HIV also going down. Simply because 3 years back, we had a little around 1 million people on treatment. But just last 18 months, we were able to add to that number 350,000 people, a feat that has never been done by any country globally in terms of HIV programming and delivery in HIV. So this is something that Nigeria delivered despite COVID-19 pandemic. And no other country has done this without even COVID-19 pandemic. So with COVID-19 pandemic, us moving from merely 50,000 we are identifying and putting on treatment in a year to 350,000 in 18 months, this is a feat that need to be commended and has already been commended. American government has commended Nigeria, and Nigeria is now being recognized as leader in terms of identifying new cases, you know, unidentified cases of HIV, and bringing them to care. Now, this is the discussion. How many more do we need to go to say that, yes, we have identified the number we needed to identify to say we are in control. Transmission is no longer taking place. Because what the drug does is to ensure two things. One, HIV does not leave the body of somebody who has it to affect somebody who doesn't have it. The drug does this one. And the second, HIV does not kill this individual. Because for HIV to kill, we need to move from HIV to what we call AIDS. This drug prevents the occurrence of AIDS. If we have 1.9 million, 1.8 million that have this disease in the country, and now on our treatment list, we have 1.5 million. They are taking this drug, and we're making sure they're taking it the way it should be taken. And we are measuring to see how this drug is suppressing the virus in them. We should be talking about less number of new cases of HIV that will be seen. We should be talking about less number of death from HIV. And that is exactly, I think, what is happening at the moment.
Okay, let me take you up on the case of testing and you emphasizing on new identified cases here. Now, we've heard about self-testing kits. How really does this work? Or how does it really work, you know, considering that people that may test positive after this test may not want to own up?
Okay. HIV programming globally has been on now for 40 years. The global community has been fighting HIV. And here in Nigeria, certainly we have been in it aggressively for the last two decades. In those last two decades, we had a number of people that have HIV that are less than 2 million, but we only get to know 3 years back. However, all this time, we have been to all places, to all facilities, calling for people to test for HIV and know their status and put them on treatment. But what was the result? The result has been a barrier that has come in between us and people knowing about their HIV status. Even when people know that this medication do the wonders and this medication prevent people from spreading the virus, this medication prevent the virus from killing people, and in fact, they make people that live with the virus look normal, they shine, they look like fresh tomatoes, they look better when in the eyes of people when it comes to looking for somebody that is looking health than you and myself. But has that helped us to bridge this gap, to take this thing, this barrier that is called stigma and discrimination that has stood between us and finding 1.8 million people that have the HIV, to find them, to bring them to treatment? All this time, 20 years now, we were only able to identify 1.5 million and bring them to treatment. So that is to show you what stigma and discrimination has done to the fight against HIV and what it will continue to do to the fight, control HIV and sustenance of that control. The rapid test kit is one of the measures to help individual to feel comfortable, to feel secure that they can do it by themselves. And they can know without anybody knowing whether they have the disease or they don't have. And if they know, they can actually safely find a location where they can take this medication without anybody knowing.
Well, that's nice. You know, the access to the antiretroviral drugs, you know, still, from what we understand, you know, is still an issue in Nigeria. What are you doing about this in the long term?
At the facility level, for the patient that need this drug, it's not an issue at all. We have this medication all over the country. This medication are there sitting and waiting for people to come and take them. However, if you talk about access to the drug by a program like myself, by NACA, by the national program, yes, I can say we have an issue there, simply because we don't manufacture this drug in country. So we need to manufacture this drug in country. We need to make sure this drug are readily available when we need them. Right now, even if I have the money and I place an order today, it will take nothing less than 6 to 7 months before the drug is delivered here for me to distribute nationwide. and that is an issue. If we can have this drug manufactured in country, that time will be reduced by half or more than half, in the sense that the time it takes for the drug to be manufactured from the time the order is placed to the time the drugs are ready is a little around 100 days, which means you need about 2 to 3 months to manufacture this drug after order placement. If this drug are manufactured in Nigeria, it will take me 1 to 2 weeks after they are manufactured to have them and distribute them nationwide. But because they are not manufactured in Nigeria, I need to source them outside. By the time they are manufactured there, before they can come, they take another 3 months. So if we can have that capacity to manufacture in country and make it available, fine. And the money that is made available from government, if that money can be made available a year prior, that would be good. That means money that is meant to purchase the drug for 2021 should be made available to NACA in 2020, so that NACA can place the order. By January 2021, we can have this drug ready in country. Otherwise, anyhow we do it, later, this thing is going to be a challenge. It's already a challenge, but now it is not showing simply because we have a kind of a program where we align, which means the donor agencies that are providing medication and they are also buying, they are bringing, we put it in a pool. If I don't have, or where a supply doesn't have, I take. By the time I have my drugs, I know place. So, but a time will come when the only implementer in country will be the government of Nigeria. After we must have control, after we must have put structures across for sustainability, then we will be in charge. So by that time, and before that time, we need to make sure we have structures in place that will ensure sustainability.
So now that we know that it's very important for us to produce these drugs in country, what is the challenge? What's really hindering? Is it that we don't have the capacity to do that?
We do. We do, but one thing is, before you manufacture these drugs, and also other drugs that you see, there are procedures globally. And this is not does not only apply to Nigeria, it applies to every country in the world. If we manufacture this drug, we only don't mean that it must be bought by Nigeria and be used in Nigeria. We want whoever is manufacturing to be in charge of West African market. We want Ghana to come and buy. We want Cameroon to come and buy. We want countries outside this territory to come and buy from Nigeria. And that will bring more job employment for Nigeria and more wealth in terms of tax. However, our local manufacturers must step up. This thing we call WHO pre-qualification is not negotiable. You must have it before you manufacture these drugs. And if you must manufacture them to the extent that others will come and put their money to buy, that is conditioned. However, if we just want to do it for our own consumption the way we want to do it, nobody will prevent us from doing it. But globally, we need to be seen to be doing the science right.
Okay. Now, relatively to these drugs, you know, when will Nigeria key into, you know, the long-lasting injectables we normally hear of, instead of the daily pills that people take, which they normally find it boring and sometimes they forget?
So this is an issue that perhaps probably the more we understand, the more we have granular data on the long injectable drugs, the more we may feel comfortable to allow it to be practiced here. Simply because when there is a new drug or there is a new way of administering medication, you need to sit down carefully and have data and see how these patients are faring and see whether by the time you introduce it, you're going to have things that are obvious to deal with, and then you get ready for them. However, even if you injection.
Okay, so when it comes to vaccines, you know, the momentum, you know, that really came along with finding vaccines for the COVID-19. Do we have the same momentum, you know, carried along with HIV and AIDS?
We have had the momentum for HIV at the beginning of the HIV epidemic and midway into the HIV epidemic, but now that momentum had disappeared simply because HIV is an entirely different virus from the virus, the like of virus that cause COVID-19. It's an unstable virus. It's a virus that changes its shapes and forms, and is a virus that you cannot target and continue to get it, which means this other virus, you can manufacture something that can target and hit and continue to have them. But HIV is a virus that constantly changes, and it's a virus that when you manufacture something today, in a matter of time, it may develop resistance and run away from it. But for the vaccine, you need what they call correlate of infection, something that is obvious that when you use them and you manufacture a vaccine, that vaccine will get virtually every HIV, every form of HIV virus, which are different and varied. That vaccine has not seen the light of the day as of today as we're talking. We are praying and hoping that that time may come. But right now, we don't have a timeline.
Well, we also understand that in the same light, one of these African countries recently had to run a clinical trial for a particular vaccine for HIV and AIDS. Can you keep us up to date with that?
There are several vaccines candidates that have been tested in Africa, outside Africa, in Asia, and some are still being manufactured in terms of design, you know, at the laboratory level to see whether they can work. But none of them has promised, you know, to do what is needed.
Okay, Doctor, would you say we, in trying to achieve the 90-90-90 target in Nigeria, you know, what are we talking about when we also talk about 95-95-95? How do we relate this? What is the achievement level of this?
90-90-90 was the global target for 2020. 95-95-95 is the same global target for 2025. Nigeria has done tremendously well in the last 18 months in terms of our move to achieve 90-90-90. Some countries in the world have achieved 90-90. Others are struggling to achieve 90-90-90. A lot have seen their progress towards 90-90 thwarted by COVID-19. Nigeria has seen its progress towards 90-90 improve drastically over the last 18 months, with Nigeria identifying people who have not been identified in the past and placed on treatment 350,000. We moved from barely 67% in our ranking on 1990 to today, as I'm talking to you, about 80%. So this double digit fiat is what we aim to reproduce in the next 18 months. And if we do that, Nigeria will be there, 95-95-95, by the end of 2022, earlier, 3 years earlier, before 2025.
Okay, let's come closer to the people now. What can you say about, you know, the prevention of mother to child, you know, transmission, and also the Global Fund? How have we, what is the progress so far? What have we achieved in this regard?
We've just recently had a meeting of stakeholders on prevention of mother-to-child transmission. This is one thing that we put as our must close this agenda item for the next 18 months, because you cannot tell the global community that we have controlled HIV in Nigeria and HIV transmission is no longer taking place in Nigeria without making significant progress on reducing mother-to-child transmission. Every year, about 8 million Nigerian women become pregnant and they deliver. But every year, we have access to barely about 2 million that we test them to find out their HIV status during that pregnancy, making sure that the HIV in them, if we find, does not affect their baby and they don't give that HIV to their unborn baby. What we will do in the next 18 months is to make sure we find a way to have access to the majority that we don't have access before. The balance of 6 million that we don't see in our facilities, that they don't come to our hospitals to deliver, we will find a way to get to them to make sure once a woman is pregnant, whether she's in a village or she's in a city, whether she comes to hospital for antenatal or she doesn't come to hospital for antenatal, she has access to HIV testing services and she gets to know her status. And if she has HIV, she does everything to make sure the baby doesn't have it, and we help her.
Okay, so let's also throw a little beam on the Global Fund. You know, there was news, you know, around the social media particularly that there was some kind of misappropriation of this fund. What is the state of things concerning that?
Well, you see, there is no way you work every day, you know, even outside government, that you don't have people who don't have any work to do rather than spread mischief. They are there every time, everywhere. And of course they are there when they see you are making progress and they feel like, oh, they need to create a confusion somewhere and have people to suspect that something wrong is going somewhere, you know, for just public attention to be attracted towards you. This is not the first time. Last year we had it. When we say we are buying drug outside Nigeria and we are buying drug directly from companies and we are not using vendors, people came out and fought us. They fought us and we fought back. And today they are defeated. And they are not ashamed that they are defeated. They are finding ways to now reincarnate and come back and say, there is something wrong in NACA. But there is nothing. Let me tell you, the money that is managed in NACA by Global Fund, from Global Fund, is not managed by NACA alone. Mm. And it's not also managed by any entity that received Global Fund money in the country. Global Fund money comes to government and goes to private sector. And they are managed. And they are managed together with Global Fund. First of all, Global Fund has implementing structure, which Global Fund hires and pay. And these are project management units. We have them in NACA. They are funded by Global Fund, they are hired by Global Fund, they are not hired by myself. Second, Global Fund has auditors that are engaged that audit Global Fund grant every year on annual basis. And these are Deloitte, Akintola, Williams & Co. These are Global Fund auditors. They are certified auditors. They audit NACA, Global Fund account, wherever it is here in this country, every year. And as the project is implemented, there are auditors that audit the implementation. And these are fiduciary agents. This is a German company. They have workers here in Nigeria. They review every payment before those payments are made. And they assign to it, they approve it before it is made. So if it is made and there is fraud, they are part of the fraud. If it is made and there is misappropriation, they are part of the misappropriation. And after these payments are made, there is another local funding agent that now look at all payment post-payment. And now they look at it and see if there are frauds, if something is missed somewhere along the way, they bring it up. With this arrangement, there is just no way that funds from Global Fund can be mismanaged or misappropriated. None. And people should remember also that the Global Fund also has what is called country team in Geneva. This country team are part and parcel of the implementation. They are carried along in everything that is done. And things go back to them for approval and it come back here. And here in country, you have a mechanism that the country has. We call it country coordinating mechanism for Global Fund. It has Nigerians in it, it has civil society in it, it has virtually every society that needs to be there is represented. And these are also watchdog of how Global Fund money is appropriated, how Global Fund money is spent, and how projects are implemented, and how deliverables are achieved.
So for somebody to Kaka did was when the request was made, NACA contacted Global Fund. And now Global Fund reviewed the request. And now they now give approval that that information can be shared. And that was when the information was shared.
Finally, before I let you go, you know, let's talk about the patient, you know, the AIDS patient, you know. Is there any mechanism in place of empowering these patients, you know, going by high cost of drugs and their diet? What are you doing about that? Let's close with that.
The AIDS patients have what we call support group. This support group educates the individuals that are within that network, and they provide information. And of course, when there are opportunities, you know, in terms of support, diets and whatever, they make it available and people get it. Our responsibility is to make sure that the medication, the clinical care, they need it, they get it. The information about the right, they get it. When they have stigma and discrimination that affect them, you know, we come to their aid. We provide them legal assistance. And when their rights are trampled upon, we call on National Human Rights Commission to take a look at it and come to their aid.
Okay. And before we go, do you have one last word to Nigerians, you know, when it concerns to, you know, what you're doing to manage HIV and AIDS in Nigeria and also to patients? Do you have one last parting word?
One last parting word is we all have responsibility as Nigerians to control HIV and make sure we end HIV as an epidemic in Nigeria and as an epidemic globally. The one way we can help and contribute is to know our status individually. Please go and know your status today. If you're HIV positive, call us.
Well, Dr. Gambo Aliyu, thank you so much for sharing your time with us on Issues of the Moment. Thank you so much for coming.
My pleasure. All right. Thank you.
Well, this is Issues of the Moment, and this is where the program ends. I have been speaking with the Director General of the National Agency for Control of AIDS, NACA, Dr. Gambo Aliyu. And we've been talking about AIDS and COVID-19 in Nigeria. Thank you so much for watching. My name is Justin Bemunyi.